Amen. All right. Get the lights turned back on. And also, who needs a Bible? Want to raise your hand? And we'll have our ushers come forward and hand you a Bible. We've got some to hand out. All right. So if you don't have a Bible, raise your hand. Okay. So it's awesome that we finished 1 Corinthians, right? We got our new little picture here that our friend Chris made us from Calvary Chapel Santee. First Timothy is the book we'll be in. So obviously this is the first week we're doing it, so it'll be 1 Timothy chapter 1. Who went to Grubstakes Parade or anything like that? Raise your hands. Wow, man, that thing, no one. Okay, well, here's what happened. Here's how I got to Grubstakes. So basically what I did was I had to get my hair cut, and I knew that I had to get it cut, so I made an appointment for Saturday at 10:35. I know it sounds like a weird time, but that's the time I got, 10:35. So I leave my house 15 to 20 minutes early thinking, I'm going to make it there and be able just to sit and wait like I always do. And I leave, and I get to the 62 turning on Kickapoo, and literally, it is so traffic slammed, and the 62 shut down, and I'm going, what is going on? And it took me forever to get to where I was getting my haircut. And then I get there, and apparently everyone else had taken forever to get their haircut, so my 10:35 turned into a 12:15. And he's like, yeah, you can just go home. And I'm like, I'm not going to go home and come right back. Like, so I have Laura with me, and I see the parade going by, and so I went to the Grubstakes Parade by accident, but she absolutely loved it. In fact, she was getting so excited that she could barely contain herself. And that night was Lillian Hammett's birthday. And she goes, oh my gosh, Dad. Just trying to contain herself. She's like, this is the best day ever. And she's sitting watching these like little trucks and cars go by. I'm like, man, it does not take much to entertain your children. So if you ever think, oh man, I want to do something special for my kids, but it's going to be some grandiose thing I have to do. Listen, my daughter was fine watching like 1980s Toyotas like driving in a parade, and she was cool with it. So you could do anything to keep your kids happy. And so I just want to encourage you to pour into your children's lives and just take that time to get to know your kids. And man, I look at my daughter, and she's, you know, growing up, and she's tall, and I'm just thinking to myself, man, she's going to be old before I know it. She's going to be a teenager, and it's going to scare me. So cherish these times you have with your children if you have them, and just really love on them. So anyways, go ahead and turn open to the book of 1 Timothy for the message that I have titled, Eyes Fixed Forward. But basically, we finished 1 Corinthians, and this book sets a completely different tone than 1 Corinthians had. Basically, 1 and 2 Timothy are referred to as the pastoral epistles, and the reason why is because they're, you know, written to Pastor Timothy, who at that time was a very young pastor. And I went through 2 Timothy Sunday morning on complete accident. Basically, I meant to study 1 Timothy, and before I had realized it, I was like, this doesn't sound like 1 Timothy. And I had studied all of chapter one of 2 Timothy. And so I thought to myself, well, all right, Lord, I'll just take that as you want me to do 2 Timothy for a Sunday morning. And then I needed about a 6-week thing here because then we go to summer movie nights in July. So I was like, let's go through 1 Timothy. So if you weren't there on Sunday morning, you can get it on CD or listen to it on YouTube. But we are in 1 Timothy. And 1 Corinthians, it was, like I said, so much different. It was a corrective letter written to a church that had so much wrong with it. But this letter, it does have some corrective. In fact, most of the corrective that we're going to get to starts right off the bat. I mean, he starts dealing with the corrective part in chapter 1 where we will be. But it is full of encouragement for a young pastor who is often looked down upon. You know, it's full of wisdom and insight for him. Because Paul and Timothy, they had a very close relationship, which we're going to talk about. But it was all about this person that was older in the faith coming alongside young Timothy and raising him up alongside a young person. Paul knew that there was a special calling in young Timothy's life. And this is the next generation of the church that he's raising up. And as I did 2 Timothy, I shared with everybody, this was the last letter ever written, the last letter ever written by Paul. And I guarantee you, Timothy was holding it with tear stains on the parchment that he was holding. just crying because this is the last thing that he would ever get. This is 1 Timothy, but it's another thing. You got to know that Timothy is reading this. And it's one of those things from even our church. Our goal at Joshua Springs, one of our cornerstones, as Gerald said this morning, is raising up that next generation. Churches should be, and if they haven't been, imitating the relationship between Paul and Timothy for the life of the church. We have to be able to pour out into young people because, like Gerald said, it's always great to have older people because that's where wisdom is. But if the older people aren't pouring into the young people, we're one generation away from being a dead church. So it's important. Everyone has a role here. Whether you're older in the faith or whether you're younger in the faith, we have to be able to move forward as a family and as a team for Jesus Christ in order for us to have a healthy body growing in the Lord. You have to have that person you can look to. You have to have someone in the faith that is further along than you, and you can see in their life, their display of Christianity, their display in situations that are crazy. How do they react? You can see their faith being displayed right in front of you. So let's go ahead and read 1 Timothy, and let's read all chapter 1. It says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the commandment of God our Savior and the Lord Jesus Christ our hope, to Timothy, a true son in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. As I urged you when I went to Macedonia, remain in Ephesus that you may charge some that they teach no other doctrine, nor give heed to fables and endless genealogies which cause disputes rather than godly edification which is in faith. Now the purpose of the commandment is a love from a pure heart, from a good conscience, and from sincere faith, from which some, having strayed, have turned aside to idle talk, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor the things which they affirm. But we know that the law is good if one uses it lawfully, knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous person, but it's for the lawless and the insubordinate, for the ungodly and for the sinners, for the unholy and the profane, and for the murderers of fathers and the murderers of mothers, for manslayers, for fornicators, for sodomites, for kidnappers, liars, for perjurers, and if there are any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine, according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which was committed to my trust. And I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who has enabled me, because he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. Although I was formerly a blasphemer, and I was a persecutor, an insolent man, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was exceedingly abundant with faith and love which are in Christ Jesus. This is a faithful saying and the worthy of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. However, for this reason, I obtained mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show all longsuffering as a pattern to those who are going to believe on him for everlasting life. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. This charge I commit to you, son Timothy, according to the prophecies previously made concerning you, that by them you may wage the good warfare, having faith and a good conscience, which some having rejected concerning the faith have suffered shipwreck, of whom are Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I delivered to Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we just thank you and we love you, and Lord, we trust you just with this time. And Lord, it is so awesome to come here on a holiday weekend and Lord, just see people so hungry for you and showing up and Lord, saying no to those barbecues and a couple of the other things that might be going on right now, just to seek your face and your will for their life. So Lord, as they set this time aside, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you would speak to their heart. Lord, there the hearts in here that are hardened, the hearts in here that are confused, the hearts in here that are saddened, whatever it is, Lord, or the hearts in here that are just happy and joyful, Lord, that you would become everything that you need to be to all of them. Lord, we know that a pastor's words or anybody's words are just words, Lord, without the Holy Spirit backing them. So Lord, you have to speak through me, Lord God, to make this matter. So Lord Jesus, we love you and thank you for this time. We thank you for this church. We thank you for the ability, Lord, to be able to gather here. And Lord, we just pray the enemy away from us, Lord, that this could be a sweet time of spirit speaking to spirit. And Lord, you're just amazing. And Lord, you are so worthy to have all of our time. And Lord, just let this be a wonderful thing, Lord, as we seek your face. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's go ahead and look at verses 1-4. It says again, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God, our Savior, and the Lord Jesus Christ, our hope. To Timothy, a true son in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. I urged you when I went into Macedonia to remain in Ephesus, that you may charge some that they teach no other doctrine. It says here, nor give heed to fables and endless genealogies, which cause disputes rather than godly edification, which is in faith. So this book is most commonly believed to be written between 64 and 65 AD, which is about 3 years after Acts 28 and his imprisonment that he was in Rome. So basically, after he gets out of prison, what does Paul continue to do? Paul continues to do what he has always done, and that is what he's always done since he's been saved. That's spread the gospel, visit churches, and continue to raise up leaders. We see again and again and again, it's Paul and Timothy. Paul and Timothy, they're very, very close. Paul and Timothy were ministers, and they were in ministry at very many of the same places. Timothy listened very closely to Paul. We know that he was circumcised because of Paul and what Paul had talked to him about and these different things. He listened to Paul. He absolutely took what Paul said as, hey, I need to follow what he's telling me because this is a man of God. Timothy would travel with Paul, including here, the church of Ephesus. Basically, Ephesus is another church here, not like Corinth, but we have another church with some problems. And the problem that basically plagued this church was that there was false teachers, just like there has been in so many other churches, but false teachers that would come in, spread their false gospels, spread their false teachings, and start to lead many astray. So when Paul and Timothy, they visited this Ephesian church, Paul left Timothy there to continue to encourage and bless, but also too to preach against the people coming in and lying to the church of Ephesus. So we see how Paul starts this letter, and it's pretty normal. I mean, he always does some sort of introduction, but one thing I love is he says, the Lord Jesus Christ, our hope, to Timothy, a true son in the faith. Man, when you hear about their ministry team, they're together, you hear about Paul and young Timothy, I don't think we can even grasp how close they were, that Paul is calling him a true son in the faith. Now, if you've ever read the Bible and you read about Timothy, it talks about Timothy's mom and his grandmother, but it doesn't talk about his dad a whole lot. His dad was basically a heathen, he wasn't saved, and these different things, and you know, it wasn't his dad that was raising him up in the faith like I have the ability and I've had the ability to be raised up in the faith by my father and also too by my stepfather. You know, but he didn't have that. Well, let me tell you, maybe today your whole family's not saved. Maybe today everyone in your family is you are it. You are the one that's like, I am the only person at church. The rest of my family could care less if I'm here or you know, every time I go to Thanksgiving, it's awkward. Listen, you can find that person that will love you, that will come alongside. This is something that God provided for Timothy. Someone he could look up to. Maybe his father wasn't any sort of role model. Maybe his father wasn't anything redeemable about the guy. He might not have ever known the Lord. We don't know. We haven't heard anything else. We didn't hear if he was converted or if Paul and Timothy got a chance to preach to him and he gave his heart to the Lord. I mean, obviously, we would hope so. And we know that Timothy, I'm sure that burdened him. But at the same time, it wasn't there for him. So God provided someone to raise him up. So if you're feeling alone, open up to the people around you and let them come alongside and be that family for you. That's what the body of Christ is all about. It's not about sitting and listening to a sermon. It's about engaging with one another and growing up in each other's lives. And Paul really considered Timothy to be a son. It was so close. And then you see the basic beginning. After he says, my true son, he says, grace, mercy and peace from peace to you. And I always say this, and maybe it's cheesy, and I always make fun of pastors that say real cheesy things. I make fun of them in a playful manner, but those pastors that repeat the same thing over and over and over again whenever it comes, well, I am that guy now. And it says here, grace, mercy, and peace. And let me tell you, it's not till you recognize the grace and mercy that you've been shown that you can experience that true peace that Jesus has to offer. The amount of grace and mercy that God has shown you is should elevate him and lower you when you realize that in that order, grace, mercy, and then there's peace. So after all this introduction that happens, after this little beginning, how he always writes, it always no time jumping right into the big problem in Ephesus, and that was others teaching other doctrines, giving heed to fables, and what does it say? And endless genealogies. And the reason you got to deal with something like this right away, or someone preaching something that's not right, or someone acting not right, is because things like this can spread like wildfire. You can start confusing people that are new believers. And so instantly, he leaves him in Ephesus, writes him this letter, and Timothy needs to get to work. Many scholars of the Bible, think that these are the same people, the same type of message that was plaguing like the Colossian church. Basically, in Colossians 2:8, it says, "Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy, empty deceit, according to the traditions of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ." And another one is, "Let no one cheat you of your reward, taking delight in false humility, the worship of angels, intruding into those things which he has not seen, vainly puffed up in his own mind." So we see the same ideas probably here on display in Ephesus. We're going to go into some of them in a little bit, but this hidden knowledge that no one else knows, right? This philosophy that you just can't get by reading Bible. You have to be enlightened. These fables, this worship of angels, whatever this false teaching was, we know that it was rampant. We know that it was everywhere, and it can creep in and attach itself to the gospel, or it can creep in and attach itself to the word. That's why you can have to know what the Bible says when a pastor's teaching. When a pastor's teaching, it's a wonderful, awesome, relaxing time. When Gerald taught this morning, man, I was so blessed. Like Adam talked about the worship. Man, it's just so great to sit with believers and be able to listen to that message, to listen to that worship. But if you don't know the word, if you haven't read it on your own, you can be easily deceived if you're not following along and seeing what it really says, because that's how false teaching happens a lot. They just change it just enough to where you didn't recognize it. Now you're way over here. You're far way away. And you know what? False teachers all have one thing in common. False teachers all love to do this, and they love to bring attention to themselves by, what did I say? Adding simplicity to the gospel. It's always about giving attention to themselves. It's never about, it's never about what Jesus has done. It's always making things harder for you to obtain salvation, or that you can't obtain salvation, or only a small amount of you will obtain salvation. They twist and turn the Bible, and we see Satan did it as well to Jesus. But Jesus knows what the word and the context meant, and he argued back with Satan. So I want to encourage you to know what the word says. John Corson, I love what he says. He has advice for people who want to become Bible teachers, because we know that Timothy was a young pastor. But this is advice that John Corson gives young Bible teachers. "I give this piece of advice. Give up trying to be creative and innovative. Instead, stick with the simple, powerful truth of the gospel, and you will never go wrong." Now, some of you in here just said, "Well, that was ridiculous. I mean, don't try to be innovative. Don't try to be creative." Listen, if you think you can be more creative and innovative than God's word, the problem is you. That's the real deal, because this has been my ministry since I've gotten started. I have never cared if anyone has walked out of this room and said, "Wow, BJ is super smart, right? He is a really smart guy. I just have no clue what he's talking about." That is not my goal, to leave you guys. I would rather show you the life-changing power that changed my life, that has changed my friends' life, that has changed the dynamics on life dramatically. It's nothing I can say to you. I would rather have that life-changing power on display instead of my own ability. Because let me tell you, my own self and what I can tell you is going to run out real quickly, and you're going to see that I'm a fraud if I am not rooted in the word. A major problem with pastors and teachers today is that they want to preach something that no one has ever heard before, right? They want to preach something that no one has ever heard before, and in doing so, keeping their status of a top-tier Bible teacher until pretty soon you've heard it because it's the Bible, and they're like twisting it and throwing it crazy places. Gerald and I were talking with a pastor. It was actually Gerald talking and me listening, but I've shared this a bunch of times, but I was there for this, and the guy said, okay, so Gerald, what are you teaching for Easter? I mean, that's a pretty basic one, right? I thought maybe he wondered, like, which resurrection message are we going to give? Gerald looked at him with a deadpan face and just kind of, well, Easter, I believe I'll teach the resurrection message. And he goes, really? Don't you think they've all heard that before, though? Do you see what I mean? There are people out there trying to come up with something new and fresh instead of the as your message can be more relevant and life-changing than the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It is not about you, and the minute you think it's about you, you start fitting into what's happening with these false teachers. At no point was Paul and Timothy talking about how great they were. In fact, they were always staying humble and always living above reproach. We also sat at a pastor's conference one time, and I was sitting there, and this guy begins to talk on how to preach to millennials. Oh, they're complacent with everything. No, they're not complacent with anything. They always want more. And let me tell you, that old gospel message you used to be able to share from a Sunday morning, that has to change to have these kids listen. And Gerald looked over at me, and he goes, did he just say that we have to change the gospel message? Like, it's the gospel that's the power. False. God's word is so powerful, it has always and always will speak for itself. And on top of this idea of Ephesus, we know that there was false teaching and other things, but also the church's stance on genealogies and fables, all instead of the gospel, they would argue and there'd be disputes about it. And church, this is something that still plagues our church today. And when I say our church, I mean the church as a whole, the church body. I mean, every Christian church, we sit and we argue and we fight and divide amongst each other with non-salvation, non-sin issues. I've heard the smartest people of the faith sit there and argue till they're blue in the face, mad about things like the rapture and when it's going to happen. I've seen people argue about Calvinism versus Arminianism, and they sit there and they argue and they both think each other are wrong and they're taking stabs at each other. If you believe one, you're an idiot. If you believe the other one, how could you ever believe that? In doing so, they've been elevated. Do you guys see that? Because they have the stance, they've been elevated above others while they're all put below them. Which brings up a point, okay? Let me tell you, which brings up a point. It's healthy to know what you believe. Right? Absolutely. You should know your stance on the rapture. You should know your stance on being saved and these other things. And you know, is it people's responding to the call, or is it God chose them, or whatever it is? You should know this. And even a healthy discussion, but when you start seeing it turn south, it becomes an unhealthy dispute that has plagued the church since Bible days. We need to focus on other times, because listen, spending all the time on the internet on how to defend your stance on something that in the long run of things isn't going to matter at all, while there's major issues, oh, you know, like the world dying and going to hell, but yet we're sitting here like, well, I don't know if I believe that about the rapture. Listen, here's the best stance on the rapture. I've said it all the time. Be ready now, but be ready to go through some stuff. That's the best stance you can go through. I mean, you're ready, but if he decides to wait, you're gonna wait. I mean, that's how it works. You're not God. And so that's my best. Anything else, worrying about it and fighting about it and arguing, well, like I said, there's people dying and going to hell, is a foolish waste of time. Believers, focus on loving one another. Focus on loving the people in the world that have never heard the gospel preached, that they've only seen Christianity spoken through the media, and that we're hate mongers and all these other things. Focus on loving people and showing people the gospel, not only through your mouths, but through the example that's in your own heart, because you are a changed person in Jesus Christ. Amen. You can't lose with that message. That's the message that should move us and guide us and empower us to do everything. Verses 5 through 8 says this: "Now the purpose of the commandment is love from a pure heart, from a good conscience, and from sincere faith, from which some, having strayed, have turned aside to idle talk, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor the things which they affirm. But we know that the law is good if one uses it lawfully." So as teachers and pastors and the people that are striving to be teachers and pastors, the heart when you're preparing your message should be, "Lord, let me show the love that you have shown to me, the grace and mercy that you have shown to me, in order to bring about a heart change. One that really sees that the reason you're up there is completely not reliant on who you are as a person. It's truly you are unworthy of his grace, and you want to show others that the reason you're up here is because God's grace has put you there." How, in contrast, like this was happening then, there are many who study the Bible through a public display of their own agenda. They want to show everyone exactly what they think, their own opinion, in order to gain what? Attention, power, status, and respect. All these things that can be gained from twisting the words and making yourself sound smart, and you kind of leave Jesus by the wayside. We have to be careful when the message that someone's bringing to you on the television starts talking about themselves nonstop, or starts talking about the good feeling of Jesus without quoting any sort of scriptures, the whole message, there's something wrong happening. And you see these whole stadiums full of 30,000 people, you're going, what is happening? They're being deceived, a lot of them. Listen, anytime you feel the desire or hunger to be a teacher, make sure you're doing it out of the right heart. Make sure you're doing it for one that desires to show people Jesus and to see Jesus' name lifted high and not your own. James 3:1 says this: "My brethren, let not many of you be teachers, knowing that we shall receive a stricter judgment." As a teacher, we know that there's an accountability, not only for what we teach, but also to the heart behind our teaching. Where were we when we studied it? Were we spending time with the Lord, or were we just trying to whip it out? And this convicts me as a pastor and as a teacher, as it should anybody who teaches any sort of Bible study. Where are you when you're speaking about the Lord? Where's your heart when you're speaking about the Lord? Because if you're not being filled with the Holy Spirit, you're pouring out yourself. You're pouring out yourself to people. And let me tell you, it's so funny, because when it says here, when it says, "which some having strayed have turned aside to idle talk, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor the things which they affirm." Listen, there are, will be, and there have been actually recently, people that have these ideas where they show up out of nowhere and they want to pull you aside and they want to say this, like, "The Lord has shown me a divine revelation, and I need to tell your whole church this hidden wisdom which has never been shown before. I can't make this stuff up." Like, literally this has happened within the last month, okay? Someone shows up, they tell us that they have this divine revelation from the Lord that they need to share with an abundance of people. It can't just be me. It has to be everybody. We gotta throw them up there on stage, right? And they want to instruct the people, especially the pastors, with what they're doing wrong. We don't know who they are. We don't know where they came from. They just need that moment to tell everybody how wrong and how sinful they are, or whatever they're going to say, right? And if you want to know what can make pastoral staff, including your elders of your church, extremely on guard, go up to Gerald. I dare you. Go up to Gerald and say, "Gerald," and actually, I want to encourage you to do this maybe on a Sunday morning. Go up to Gerald and say this: "Gerald, I need to talk to you." And he'll say, "Yeah." And go, "I got a divine revelation from the Lord. He only revealed it to me. It's hidden wisdom, and I need to share it on a Sunday morning." Watch what happens. I challenge you all to do that to him on Sunday, okay? There's a lot of us here, but watch what happens. His face goes from like this. If his face goes from... It'll be great. Try it. These type of people that want to see themselves elevated. And listen, there's always going to be those two types of people. Those pastors that have that pastoral heart. They want to teach because they love Jesus, and they believe the only thing and the only cure that they can give you is Jesus. I love it when people are like, "Pastor, can you tell me something? Can you just give me something?" But don't root it in the Bible. Just tell me. It's like, no, because everything that we are and the only thing that fixes your life is Jesus. It's like the people that want me to marry them, but they don't want me to mention the word Jesus. They don't want me to do any of this. It's like, listen, the marriage isn't going to work unless you center it on Jesus, so I can't do that. I'm really sorry, right? So there'll be the people that love people and they want to preach because they love Jesus. And there's also the ones that want to elevate themselves through their own interpretation of Scripture. And here, a lot of those teachers that were elevating themselves were teachers of the law, more specifically the five books of the Bible. And they would do it in order to elevate themselves and to put others under their thumb. And Paul in the next verses is going to talk about the law. We're going to explain it. We explained it a little bit in 1 Corinthians, but we're going to explain it a little bit more here in 1 Timothy. So it says in 9 through 11, it says, actually let's read 8 through 11. It says, but we know that the law is good if one uses it lawfully. Knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous person, but for the lawless and the sinners. Is my mic cutting out a little bit? Okay. For the ungodly, it says, knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous person, but for the lawless and insubordinate, for the ungodly and for sinners, for the unholy and profane, for the murderers of the fathers and murderers of mothers, for manslayers, for fornicators, for sodomites, for kidnappers, for liars, for perjurers, and if there is any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine, according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which was committed to my trust. So these false teachers would teach the law without understanding the law. Who else did that in the Bible? The Pharisees, right? The Pharisees always taught the law. And in fact, Jesus had something to say to them. And Gerald, it's so funny, as he was teaching this morning message, I was like, so much of our message is copying one another. And basically I stole this from him because I was gonna do Matthew 23, 11 through 13, but when he read this, I was like, I've gotta throw that in there. So Matthew 23, 2 through 5 says, the scribes and the Pharisees, this is Jesus speaking about the Pharisees who would take the law and make it hard for anyone to come to Jesus or come to God. It says, the scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. Therefore, whatever they tell you to observe, that observe and do, but do not do according to their works. For they say, and do not do. For they bind heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on men's shoulders. But they themselves will not move, they will not move them with one of their fingers. But all their works they do to be seen by men. And in Matthew 23, 11 through 13, it goes on to say, but who is greatest among you shall be your servant, and whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in. Pharisees were making it so hard to attain salvation by the rules that they weren't even able to follow themselves. We have to realize, and we have to know as believers, that if anyone preaches that we need to do things, if we need to do things to be saved, that they are lying to you. Apart from Jesus Christ and the blood that was shed, there is nothing else that needs to happen. Believing in your heart, confessing your sins, and just giving it, confessing with your mouth and believing in your heart. We have to realize that the law in the Bible, what does it say? That it's not for the righteous. Right? We have to realize that the law is not a list of commands that we all need to follow, that we have to live by to be saved, or if you want to live a happy life, or you want to make God more pleased with you, follow every single law that's in the Bible. Instead, we know what it is. If you've been to this church and you were here this morning, Gerald told you what it is. It's a guide showing believers and unbelievers the bar and how far we are from it, and how horrible we really are. If you start thinking you're pretty good and you're pretty, oh, I'm pretty spiritual, look at the Old Testament. Try to start following that and you'll see real quick that you need a savior, that you need someone that could do that. And there's only one person that could follow every single law of God, and that is God himself, and that is Jesus. And if you don't identify as Jesus being the perfect person that paid the price for everything, then you are sorely mistaken, and you're going to be in for a rude awakening someday when your righteousness doesn't match up to anything. It's very, very, very important that you realize that it is all about Jesus. That was not my phone, just so everyone knows. As we come to Jesus, believers, saints, we are no longer under the law. We are no longer under this, but we are in a relationship with the one who fulfilled it all. That doesn't mean that we throw it out the window. Listen, God's desire for us is to have a beautiful, wonderful, freedom-filled, victorious life and a relationship with Him. He wants you to be free. He wants you to get into His Word. He wants you to pray. He wants you to live your life like Jesus. That's what He wants. He doesn't want you to elevate yourself by feeling that you're more spiritual and that you've done A, B, and C every day for your whole life and somehow you've obtained it all. He wants you to look like Him. He wants by His Holy Spirit to mold you and to shape you and to allow you to allow yourself to look more and more like Him. And the more time you spend focused on Jesus, your life will be transformed into one that looks similar to His because He resides inside of you. It's no longer in a temple. He lives inside your heart. He doesn't want you to carry the burden of not matching up. He doesn't want you to cry and be shameful because you couldn't match up to this. Listen, when you sin, absolutely, man, when you realize that man, you messed up, man, there's many times where I've cried because I have sinned. But He doesn't want you to sit in this state of depression over your sin because He looks at you when you have fallen before the cross and said, Lord, I'm sorry. He tells you, stop spending so much time at the foot of the cross and start living in the victorious life that I've given you. Start living your life. You don't just recognize with the death anymore. You recognize with the resurrection. And what was happening here, there's people heaping on the laws and people were feeling more and more spiritual by following in a certain way or doing certain things. And listen, we need to reside with Jesus. We need Him to lead our life. But the law is perfect. The law is good because we absolutely need the law for those who are not walking with Him, for those who do not have Jesus. The law brings us to Jesus, broken, right? We're going to turn to Romans 7. If you want to turn there with me, we're going to spend a little bit of time there. Romans 7. Verses 7 through 25. This explains the law, right? This explains it perfectly. It says here, what shall we say then? Is the law sin? Certainly not. On the contrary, I would not have known sin except if it wasn't through the law. For I would not have known covetousness unless the law had said, you shall not covet. But sin, taking opportunity by the commandment, produced in me all manner of evil desire. For apart from the law, sin was dead. I was alive once without the law, but when the commandment came, sin revived and I died. And the commandment which was to bring life, I found to bring death. For sin, taking occasion by the commandment, deceived me, and by it killed me. Therefore, the law is holy, and the commandment holy, and just and good. Has then what is good become death to me? Certainly not. But sin, that it might appear sin, was producing death in me through what is good, so that sin through the commandment might become exceedingly sinful. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. For what I am doing, I do not understand. For what I will to do, that I do not practice, but what I hate, that I do. If then I do what I will not to do, I agree that the law, that it is good. But now it is no longer I who do it, but sin who dwells in me. For I know that in me, that is my flesh, nothing good dwells. Can I get an amen? for it to will is present with me, but how to perform what is good I do not find. For the good that I will to do, I do not do, but the evil I will not to do, that I practice. Now, if I do what I will not to do, it is no longer I who do it, but the sin that dwells in me. I find then a law that evil is present with me, the one who wills to do good. For I delight in the law of God according to the inward man. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with my mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. Does you guys understand a little bit now? Grace leads you to obedience. Grace leads you to that freedom and that victory and this legalism of having to match up to everything. Listen, everyone understands what it's like to have a heart that wants to serve the Lord, but you're like, why did I fall there again, Lord? Why did I stumble in that area again? It's because you're warring within yourself. You're stuck in this flesh. You're born into sin, but yet you're changed, man. You're completely new. And so there's this war going on. But the legalism that some people, and especially in Ephesus and these other places, this legalism and all these laws that they would put on you, it was leading to more and more bondage. It exhausts you. How can I live up to everything? How can I do all of this? And that's what people think of Christianity in the world. They think it's a whole bunch of just laws and rules, and they don't understand. It's 100% about a relationship. And that's why when we say Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship, to them it sounds like some hokey little saying that we say, but really it is. We're not trying to match up to be perfect or good. We're matching up to want to follow Jesus and in his footsteps, amen? So let's look at 12 through 17. Says, and I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who has enabled me because he counted me faithful. I underline that. Putting me into the ministry, I highlighted that. Although I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, an insolent man, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in belief. And the grace of our Lord was exceedingly abundant with faith and love which are in Christ Jesus. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. However, for this reason, I obtained mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show all longsuffering as a pattern to those who are going to believe on him for everlasting life. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever. Amen. Saints, one thing I see that it says here when I look at it in verse 12, and I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, who has enabled me because he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. Who puts pastors into their positions? You know, is it Gerald? You know, is he the final say? Is he the one that gets to pick them as they come? Man, what a lucky guy he gets to be, right? It's the Lord that picks those positions. It's the Lord speaking to people's hearts. Listen, it is up to Christ to put people in the ministry. All the church does is recognize that call on the individual. I've seen it 100 times with either my father or through Gerald or one of these different things. It doesn't matter how much someone wants to call themselves a pastor, okay? Doesn't matter if they want to always label themselves the pastor of this. I'm the pastor of this ministry and the pastor of this ministry, and I wrote pastor on my Bible, and I write pastor so-and-so when I sign my checks, and I'm a pastor. The church doesn't make you a pastor or a leader. It's not the church. And listen, it doesn't matter if you went online and got ordained for your 1999 from the First Church of the Good, because you can do that as well and be an ordained minister, an ordained pastor. You can do that right now. Google it. I want to be ordained. And it'll be like, oh, you're now officially ordained. It means absolutely nothing. If you want us to ordain you, we'll make up some crazy name and be like, hey, you're ordained under the First Church of the Good. You know, it's like, it makes no sense because it's God who picks it. You don't force yourself into that position. It is God who calls and the church to recognize the calling. Man, I think of Dave Rose, right? Dave Rose was a guy who did a free from bondage ministry, an ex-drug addicts and any sort of addictions. He did this study, right? Dave just made himself, Dave just walked with the Lord, was everywhere he needed to be because he was following Jesus, and he would do anything he was called to do as long as it was with what the Lord had called him to do. It was something that God had put into him. And so we began to recognize Dave Rose. Like, it wasn't that we were like, Dave, you're now a leader. You are, listen, we never once called him a leader of this church or a pastor of this church. People just followed him. It was a gifting that he had inside of him that God had called him to be a pastor. And it doesn't matter if anyone actually ever said, Pastor Dave Rose. Listen, he was going to be a pastor because God had ordained him to be a pastor. Man, he just loved people. He had a heart to do. Listen, when I went to Idaho, he told me, he said, man, I know the Lord has called me to go with you. Okay, and when I know that the Lord has called me back home, he said, I feel like the Lord has still called me to Idaho. Told Gerald, told me, and listen, at that moment, the Lord began to actually have everyone recognize him. Wow, I mean, we are recognizing this call in your life. We heard him teach. We saw how he could lead. It was like he was there. It was trial by fire with what he was going through. And now his church in Gooding, listen, it's the same way with Yucca. Without this church, Yucca would not be the greatest place to live, okay? Gooding is not the greatest place to live, but he has this church. And because of the church, it's going to make the whole community a better place. And it's not because of anything that's within him. And it's not because that we said he's a pastor. It's because the Lord had ordained him. There's no hierarchy of scale of, okay, we got children's pastor, junior high. I mean, we like to do this. I mean, if you ever go to a youth workers conference, it's a very real thing. They're like, oh, you're junior high youth pastor? Well, maybe next year you'll be high school. Then after that, we get to be assistant pastor. And then, oh, you forgot all about young adults pastor. Then you'll be young adults pastor. Then you're senior pastor. Oh, no, you skipped assistant. There's no hierarchy. And we always act like there's some crazy hierarchy. We always like try to say, well, if you're God could never take a high school person and put him to senior. Or God could never take someone that's in the addictions ministry and make him to a senior pastor of his own church and blessed him with a hospital-sized building. But God doesn't work like that. God calls the person. And listen, I want you to know another thing is God is not concerned with any of your past mistakes. God didn't look at who Dave Rose was and said, well, Dave, it looks like you've disqualified yourself forever. Like, since you didn't know me for a long time and you came into Christianity later on in your life, well, I can never, ever use you to be a senior pastor. But you can always be that children's pastor. You know, like that hierarchy we talk about, right? God is not concerned with past mistakes. He's not concerned with what you did before you came with him. Listen, Paul was a blasphemer, a persecutor, an insolent man. In fact, he said, this is a great saying, I am the chief of sinners. I am the chief. Wouldn't that be a great resume, right? You go in and you think you might be getting this job as on pastoral staff, you know, your pastor's called, and they're like, what actual giftings do you have? And you're like, well, basically I'm a persecutor, an insolent man. I'm the chief of sinners. I think I have quite the resume. You should hire me, right? But listen, it's God who makes us anew. It's God who saves us. That's why he's willing to say these things. Listen, I was this, but I'm not that anymore. And God used me regardless of who I was when I came to him. And when you see the amount of long suffering and patience that God has had with you through your whole life, if you are in this room and maybe you came to the Lord a little bit later on in your life, you know, maybe you just constantly lived for yourself. And God continued to suffer long, continued to have patience, continued to reach out. And finally, you answer that call and you're like, Lord, you had so much patience for the things I've said and the things I've done and the people I've treated poorly and all these different things. Lord, thank you for having that long suffering. And now the Lord says, you know that long suffering I showed you? Show the same long suffering for the people that need to come to me. That's exactly what it's talking about. to have that long suffering with the people that can sometimes, I mean, it's funny because we like to pretend like talking about Jesus is going to be easier. Telling someone that they need a savior is going to be easy and they're going to accept it with open arms. No, listen, there's a reason it's called long suffering. Because you're going to suffer long for the case of Christ. You're going to suffer long for the gospel message, but there's nothing more fulfilling and there's nothing more worthy of suffering than sharing Jesus, the message of Jesus, the message of the gospel. Listen, today, if you, like I said, if you have had a past, and I know we've all had pasts, we've all had pasts marked with sin. Listen, today, you can't allow that past to dictate your future. Christ is ready to use you regardless of who you are. Leave the past in the past and move forward. Well, the past was only an hour and a half ago. Well, leave that hour and a half in the past and move forward with the Lord. Well, literally, the past was 6 o'clock, like 5:59. That was my past. Like, I sinned right before I walked through the door. Well, leave it at the door. Walk in that newness of life that God gave you. You know, listen, Paul could have been crippled by what he had done. I could never, ever, and listen, he allowed everything within him, everything that he had done to injure the church or to oppress the church, to move him forward and believe in his calling. He chose to believe in his calling. And in verse 17, he says this, now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever, amen. Man, maybe as we're speaking, you guys had a flash of who you were before you came to Christ. You were like, oh my gosh. You're right. Holy cow, he has saved me from a lot. Listen, maybe now you had the who you were in the past and that fast forward to who you are now. Isn't verse 17 appropriate for what God has done to sing his praises? Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. When he starts to be reminded of who he was and where he is now and how God is using him and blowing people's minds, he begins to worship and to sing his praises. It's a good way to keep yourself grounded as you begin to move forward in ministry. Remind yourself who has put you there. Remind yourself the gifts that God has given you, allowed you to serve, to speak, or work for his people. Praise God for what he's done. Let's finish up with 18 through 20. It says, this charge I commit to you, son Timothy, according to the prophecies previously made concerning you, that by them you may wage the good warfare, having faith and good conscience, which some, having rejected concerning the faith, have suffered shipwreck, of whom Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I delivered to Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. Man, as believers walking in this world, I mean, it can be hard sometimes to walk, and especially walking with the Lord. Man, when you walk with the Lord, you are going to be faced with opposition from the enemy at all times. And you may be even hearing from people that you can't do that, or, you know, these different things. Listen, you have to believe in the call on your life like Timothy did. How did he have this? How did he believe in this call in his life? How did he believe in it? It says, have faith and good conscience. Well, how do you have a good conscience when you know who you were before you came to Christ? Listen, you have a good conscience by treasuring and holding the cross of Christ above everything else in your life. You want to know how you can have a good conscience? How you want to know if you're living right with the Lord? Is Jesus Christ the number one thing in your life? Above every hobby, above your family, above your spouse, above your child? Is there anything that's going to change the relationship that you have with God? You have to make that stance. Lord, I don't know what's going to happen in my life, and people can come against me. People in my life can die that I don't feel like they should have went and saw you, yet I had years to learn, I had years to grow with them. Listen, but Lord, if that stuff does happen, I'm treasuring and holding the cross above any of my mistakes and failures and worries and doubts. Are you having a good conscience? Are you having faith, believing that it is all about him? Let him empower you. Because if we lose or reject the truth, the law of God, the love of Christ, the life of faith that he has called us to, listen, we will suffer shipwreck. Like it says here, Paul mentions Hymenaeus and Alexander. We don't know exactly what they did, but we know in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 16 through 18, he mentions Hymenaeus. He says, "But shun profane and idle babblings, for they will increase to more ungodliness, and their message will spread like cancer. Hymenaeus and Philetus are of that sort, who have strayed concerning the truth, saying that the resurrection is already past, and they overthrow the faith of some." If you begin to get your eyes focused on other things or on other people, listen, there's a lot of people that have their eyes focused on no one but the pastor. And if something happens to the pastor, all of a sudden they lose their faith. I only come to church if it's Gerald teaching. I only come to church if it's BJ teaching. I can't listen to anybody else if they stand up and listen and talk. Listen, then you've got it twisted. Because all we're doing is preaching the gospel message that Jesus has given to each and every single one of us. We're just using the giftings that God has given to each and every single one of you. God has given you that gospel to move you forward and to use your gifts and talents and abilities, whatever it is. Well, I'm not a speaker. Well, not all of us are speakers. Not all of us are the mouths. We went through that, remember? We all have the same worth. But listen, if you begin to get your eyes focused on anything else but Jesus, you're going to stray. And what happens when you begin to stray? What did Gerald say at the end of his message today? He said, listen, if you become bitter, if you allow one of these things to come in your life and to make you bitter, you're going to go on to the next place. And guess what's going to happen? You're going to be a problem there too. You're going to be bitter. You're going to be angry because your eyes are not focused on what Jesus is doing. Bring your eyes back to Jesus in your situation today. Bring your eyes back onto the cross and knowing that God is in control. That's why it's keeping your eyes fixed on the cross of Jesus. And it says that Paul had to deliver these men to Satan. What is that about, right? I picture him, Satan, they're yours, you know, you got them, you know. It's not like that at all. In fact, it was hard for him to do and hard for him to say. This was done in love for them. Man, sometimes when things got so bad that they wouldn't listen to Paul, they wouldn't listen to any other church leaders, and listen, these people had talked to them numerous times. The person wouldn't listen to the truth in the message. It continued to spread. You don't know what to do. Listen, Paul, being the leader, said he delivered them to Satan, which means to remove them from the comfort of the fellowship that they have in the church and to pray that God would show them the error of their way. They were actually removed from the body. Well, why would that happen? Because maybe by giving them the world that they think that they want or the message that they think that they want to deliver that's not true, showing them the severity of what they've been doing, that prayerfully it would lead them to repentance. Once that safety net is taken away, it is meant to restore the brethren. It isn't to keep them out of the church forever, to deliver them to Satan, to do with as he wills. Listen, the message is to deliver them out so that they can come back with a repentant heart and be restored. Listen, sometimes that's the only way that's the only way that things are going to happen, to wake someone up. And it's a scary thing, and I'm glad that this doesn't happen a whole lot here, but I think sometimes in some churches that the person that is constantly causing division or the person that wants to preach something that the Bible doesn't say, if that's happening in a church, instead of going, oh, well, we just kind of forgive him for leading people astray. Listen, you got to talk to him. If he's not willing to change, then it doesn't work out. If they're going to preach something not lining up with the word, then there's only one other option. Man, today, I want to encourage you guys. This is an encouraging message. I know that we started off with all the correction, but the encouraging part of this is to have confidence, assurance that Christ has become the place of law in your life. That's what I want you to be encouraged, that he gave you life and freedom to stay close to the Lord, to talk to him, to spend time with him, to grow with him. I'm going to ask the worship team to come back up here. I'm going to ask the lights to be dim as we end this last part. But listen, a big part of walking with the Lord is believing in the calling that he's giving you. Not being crippled by your fears and your past. That's a point I want you to get from this message. Don't be crippled on who you were. Have hope in what Christ has done. Doesn't matter if you think tonight that you can argue with Paul about being the chief of sinners. That doesn't matter, right? Listen, he called himself the chief of sinners. Well, then I'm the supreme captain. I'm the supreme overlord of sinners because I'm the worst. Listen, it doesn't matter who you were. It's who you are today. And let us have that teachable heart, amen? One that seeks truth, one that seeks the love of Jesus and that is not hardened and not called shipwrecked, too rigid to not be able to learn and grow. Let us never be in the place of Alexander and Hymenaeus or where we are approached with that kind of thing to happen to us. And you might be going, well, you know, it sounds good. I don't want to do that. How does that not happen? Listen, it's easy. It's easy to not get in that spot. It's by following Jesus. You keep your eyes fixed on Jesus, you're not going to go off this way. You keep your eyes fixed on Jesus and no one else, not a man, not a job, not a family member. You keep your eyes focused on Jesus and everything's going to be awesome. Like, I'm not saying that everything's going to be perfect, but everything is going to be taken care of because you believe in God's sovereignty for your life. Can I ask you a question, church? Do you believe in God's sovereignty in your life, yes or no? Do you believe that God has good things for you? Man, maybe two or three of you believe that. Do you believe God has good things for you?
Yes.
Do you believe God loves you?
Yes.
Do you believe that your past is in the past?
Yes.
Church, let's move forward with that. You guys all said yes towards the end. I think some of you finally got like, oh yeah, he wants us to say yes. Yeah. Listen, I think you guys are getting it. We move forward together. God is the one who qualifies. Has nothing to do with you. Follow Jesus. Be ready for whatever, wherever he brings you and whatever he does with you. We're going to talk more in the next few chapters, but Timothy was scared often. Timothy was scared a lot. You could be scared. But that can't move you or stray you from God's call in your life. So we're going to pray, and we're going to go back into worship. And I'm so excited to continue to go through 1 Timothy with you and to jump into some of these other chapters with you. Because there was nothing special about Timothy. He was a guy that God had called, that Paul had recognized. And for some of you, that's here today. Some of you, that is you today. Listen, that people are starting to recognize the leadership. People are starting to recognize what you're doing for the Lord. It's not because you want to be recognized. It's not because you even know you're being recognized. It's just because you're serving the Lord. And in doing so, you're being blessings to the whole church. And maybe someone's never recognized you for what you've done. Maybe you're the person that always picks up that cookie that's on the ground and no one ever says anything. Or maybe you're that person that always prays for that one person that no one goes and prays with, but he comes and prays with you because he feels comfortable. And you feel like, oh man, I've never been recognized for that. Listen, that's where you want to be. You want to be in the spot where no one is recognizing you because who sees you? Jesus. Where's your reward in heaven? Don't worry about what's going on around you. You stay focused on the Lord. You stay focused on your call. You stay believing in that. Don't become rigid. Don't become hard-hearted. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we love you. Dear Lord, we thank you for how beautifully everything went tonight. And Lord, we trust you with our lives. Lord, and like the name of the message, Lord God, that you have given to me, Lord, our eyes are fixed forward on what you have for us. Lord, our eyes are fixed forward on the rest of 1 Timothy. Our eyes are fixed forward when we leave here. Lord, we will keep looking towards you where we find our hope, where we find our grace, where we find our mercy. And in doing so, Lord, we have peace. Lord Jesus, we trust you. Lord, I pray right now for anybody's heart in here, Lord God, that is troubled or worried or any of these things, Lord. I pray that they could just believe, Lord God, in you and what you have for their life, Lord. Lord, I pray if there's people in this room that are serving for the wrong reasons, Lord. They may not be false teachers, but they might be false servants, Lord. They're just doing it to be seen by everybody or praying loudly or doing one of these things to where they can be seen by everyone that walks by. Lord, I pray that you just show their heart Lord, show them what they're doing, and Lord, that you would come in, and Lord, that you would just pour out your love and your grace, Lord. It's your grace, and it's your love, and it's your mercy that drives us to obedience, Lord, for us to fade away, and for you to be elevated, for you to be lifted high, Lord Jesus. Lord, we thank you, Lord. You are so wonderful. You are so beautiful. You are so holy. You are so worthy. We are so not, Lord. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you've made a way, Lord Jesus, and that you're in control. Lord, that your cross is powerful, Lord God. It's where we all find our strength, Lord. But when we find our strength at the foot of your cross, Lord, we get up and we live our lives for you in Jesus' name. Lord Jesus, come. Lord Jesus, come. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, for the people in this room right now, Lord God, there's hurting hearts. There's heavy hearts. Lord, come, Lord. In this room, Lord, there's stiff neck and there's rigid. Lord, come. Lord Jesus, come. And in this room, there's joy and there's peace and there's understanding. Lord, encourage and grow and strengthen in Jesus' name. And Lord, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.